Right? We talked about that, right? As we start this new series, The Housewives of Jerusalem. I need to encourage you to make certain you get here early, either on December the 15th when we do the Friday evening show, or Saturday the 16th at 1 p.m. when we do the matinee. And invite your friends. This is a great time to have them come out and see Christmas from a different perspective. We often, a lot of times when we read the Bible, we read it with veiled lenses. We don't look at people dealing with day-to-day stuff like we do today, do we? We think they're exempt because they were in the Bible days. You know we're still in the Bible days. Yeah, and real life happens to them and it happens to us, right? Life does happen, doesn't it? Yeah, so even in during all your shopping and stuff, as you're out looking for that perfect gift, you know, you either go to the mall or you go on the web and, you know, do Cyber Monday and all of that. I got a news flash for you. You're not going to find the perfect gift in the mall. Amen. You're not going to do it. And the gift that God has for you, you can't even buy. But sometimes that gift doesn't seem like it's there when you're in the midst of life. You know, most of us, how many of you want some peace and tranquility? We do, don't we? And we get small slivers of it. But when you look at what you see on the news and you see all the heinous things, it can become so depressing. And you know, this time of year is really when doctors give out more prescriptions for depression and anxiety and all of those things, when it's supposed to be a time of peace and tranquility. Well, the reason most of us can't get it is because we're looking to get that in all the wrong places. And so this is where we find our lesson text as we start this Advent season. And for many of you who may not know what Advent means, it's the time of waiting as we're anticipating Christ's coming. And for us, we're looking back to his first coming, and we're anticipating that as we celebrate Christmas. But we're also looking forward to his second coming, when he will wipe the slate clean and there will be peace and tranquility. But until then, how do you deal with life in the in-between? And so let's look at the prophetic gift. If you would, open your Bibles to the book of Isaiah. And we're going to hang out in the 11th chapter of the book of Isaiah. And if you don't have the app on your phone, YouVersion, go out and pull down YouVersion. It's a super app for Bible reading and devotion and all of those great things. It really makes studying easy. You'll be able to follow. You can set up your own devotional on there. It's got all different kind of translations, like I'm coming from the NIV today. That's Isaiah, the 11th chapter. And let's just look at verses. Let's look at 1 through 3-ish. Let's look at that. And I believe it starts like this. It says, "A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots, a branch will bear fruit." It says this. Now, look, I think this is verse number 2. It says, "The Spirit of the Lord will rest upon him." The spirit of what? Wisdom and understanding. The spirit of counsel and might. The spirit of the knowledge and the fear of the Lord. I think verse 3, part of it says, "And he will delight in the fear of the Lord." So let's look at this prophetic gift. When Isaiah wrote this book, this is about 700 years before Christ came. So that's seven centuries before Christ. And when he wrote this, King Ahaz was king, and he was a terrible king. And Isaiah had predicted that the Babylonian army was going to come in and just wipe them out. You know, we talked about when after a while God says enough is enough, right? Have you ever been a parent and said that to your children? Yeah, enough is enough, right? And mean it. Yeah, and mean it, and then carry it out. Yeah, carry out judgment. Yeah, and so God is the same way. And so with the children of Israel, he was passing this edict that enough was enough. And so there, it was very dark times. The economy was bad. There was war all around. People were being killed every time they turned on their TV back then. There was a murder on, or a child was abducted, or a ruthless leader was passing crazy laws. I mean, it was just all kind of... It was just all kind of crazy things going on, right? And so when we're living in those times, it sometimes can seem hopeless, can't it? You can just say, you know, I'm believing that there's a God. I believe that he's there. But, you know, with what I'm seeing and hearing every day, it's just hard to hang on to hope when it looks so hopeless. And so even when God has passed an edict of how things aren't going to, or how things are going to be, he never leaves us hopeless. Amen. Isn't it good that we have a God that always say, even when it's bad, there's hope? Amen. All right? And in fact, I want to talk to you first here about the promise of the gift. Look what he says here now. In that 11th chapter, after giving them all this bad news, I believe it starts in like chapter 9 through 10 up till you get to 11 here. He now says a shot will come up from the stump of Jesse. Or a shoot. Is it a shoot or a shoot? A shoot. Yeah, a shoot. I saw Sister Fag over there. I was thinking of a shot, you know, but... I'm going to leave her alone. But a shot would come up from the stump of Jesse. Now, how many of you know anything about gardening and planting and cutting down? Yeah, just what I thought, about three of you. Yeah. Yeah, if I ask you where groceries come from, y'all would probably say the grocery store. Yeah, just like our children. But a shot is just a little... A shoot, yeah, thank you. A shoot is just like a little bud on a plant, right? It's just a little bitty something, isn't it? And a stump, how many of you know what a stump is? Yeah, that's just like after a tree has been what? Cut off. And so now, what God is saying here, he says that Israel is going to be cut down. You're going to be cut off. But you know, as long as the roots are in the ground... Y'all didn't hear that. As long as the roots are in the ground and there is water and nourishment, something can start to grow. See, so when you're having a bad season in life, as long as you got the root, are you listening to me right now? As long as there's something on the inside already, and it gets nourished by the sun, and y'all listening now, and the rain comes down and waters it, he says, a shoot will come from the stump. Wait a minute. Look what it says. From the stump of Jesse. Now, this is odd because if you know anything about the Messiah lineage, it's supposed to come from whom? David. So why is he saying a shoot, I got y'all awake now, a shoot will come from the stump of Jesse. Now, here's what he's saying. Things were so bad. Watch this now. Isaiah isn't only talking about 700 years ago before Christ. He's also now talking about when Christ comes, that the lineage of David would be cut down so low that people would forget about David, and that things were so bad that they wouldn't even know what bloodline they're from. How many of you ever forgot where you come from? Yeah, sometimes you forget. And so what happens here, he's saying that when the Messiah does come, that the line of David would be cut down so low that the person whose lineage that Jesus would come through, they will forget that they had a bloodline. So in other words, when Joseph, how many of you know about Joseph and Mary? Yeah, they live around there on Georgia. No, I'm just kidding. All right, Joseph, all right, had forgotten, although he was just a carpenter, although he was a peasant, he forgot that he had the blood of the Messiah running through his veins. And so when you forget where you come from, it sometimes, can I talk plain? It affects how you behave. But if you can remember that you're a child of the Most High God, regardless of what you might be going through, regardless of how bad things might be, then you can just hold on just a little while longer, knowing that if God has made you a promise. You got to know that when God has made you a promise, it doesn't matter how things look. God has made us a promise. God has said, I'm coming back again. I know it looks bad. I know the economy, it may be roaring, but you don't have the money that you need. I know you don't have the job that you want. You may not have the mate that you want. There might be a lot of things that might not be right in your life. But if you just hold on to the promise. See, a promise delayed by God doesn't mean a promise forgotten by God. Did you hear what I just said? Yeah, so, and when God delays, he's got good reason. And so even in our dark times, there's certainty. That's your life advice. There is certainty in dark times that you just got to know that even when things don't look right, if you got a root in you, if you're from that lineage, the stump of Jesse, if you're a part of that bloodline, then regardless of how bad things look, and God has made a promise that he's coming back again, and we just need to learn how to wait. For how many of you other than me, waiting is hard? I ask God for patience, but I want it right now. Right? Yeah, let me just tell you something. Don't ask God for patience if you really don't want it. Now, I'm telling you now. You about to go through something. And, you know, he said, oh, you want some patience. Yeah, and you're talking about, I got the patience of Job. Job wasn't really patient. Job wanted that thing over. So better be careful if you start saying, I got to get me some patience. Lord, give me some. And then you're going through something. I'm going through something. Well, what you ask for? I ask for patience. Well, that's why you're going through something. Patience is hard. We don't like waiting. And our society gets us all caught up in instant everything. You can get instant everything. You get mail order brides. You can. And husbands. You can. Now, you may not. I don't know if they come with return policy. I don't know how that works and all that, you know. You see them, right? 90-day fiancé and all of that. I mean, right? Huh? Yeah. I know y'all watch that stuff on TV. Don't be looking at me like y'all. Like, if you got holy, it was on your way here. So now, when you look at a gift, God is saying he's promised you this gift. This is a prophetic gift. He's telling you, he told Isaiah 700 years earlier, before the gift came, that the gift was coming. Just like he's told us that he's coming back again. But we have to be patient in waiting, even when things look dark and dreary and things don't look like we want them to look. We can be patient in waiting on God to deliver on his promise, because a promise from God is certainty, even in dark times. That's got to be good news for somebody other than me. So watch this now. Not only is there certainty in dark times, but let's look at the packaging of the gift. Let's look at the packaging of the gift. He says here, the Spirit of the Lord will rest upon him. Now, this word rest isn't the same word rest when it talks about on the seventh day God rested. This word rest here in the Hebrew actually means to envelop and permeate. It means that the Spirit, listen to this now, it's saying that the Spirit of the Lord will envelop and permeate him. Now, you have to read this very slowly to understand what God is telling Isaiah to tell us. He's telling us now that God is going to come in human flesh. And when God comes in human flesh, that his Spirit, the Spirit of God, is going to rest, rule, and abide in the one that comes. Oh, that, y'all. See, this is why you have to understand the virgin birth. See, God needed a body to come in, but that's all he got from Mary, but he needed his own spirit to live in that body. Now, the spirit, as you read through the Bible, in fact, Isaiah talks about the Holy Spirit more than anybody else in the Old Testament. But when you read the book of Judges, it's one of the books to read. It says that the spirit of the Lord came upon someone. If you read that, you hear this over and over, that the spirit of the Lord came upon them. Well, they just got a little dose. All right. They didn't have a full dose. Are y'all with me here? A complete dose, like a double dose. All right. And so he's saying here that Jesus will be enveloped with the spirit of who? The Lord. Listen to what it says. The spirit of the Lord will, you can actually put envelop and permeate him. That's what the spirit of the Lord is going to do. Now, he gives us six attributes in couplets. But this, he's not saying that these are all the things that he will have. He's just saying that when Jesus comes, he's not coming empty-handed. Now, the other thing, when you go back and look at that shot, that shoot, right? And that branch and that stump, it talks about a branch that will produce bear fruit, right? Now, but when a stump, how does a stump look? Is it a very attractive thing? No. Is a shoot a very attractive thing? No. Is a branch a very attractive thing? No. It's the fruit that's on it, isn't it? So what he's saying is that when Jesus comes, he's not going to look good. You know, if you see a lot of pictures of Jesus, he's a nice looking man with long flowy hair and all of that. Y'all need to take all them pictures down. I don't care if he's black, white, Jew. I don't care what he is. Jesus, now, don't take this, I don't mean this in a bad way, but Jesus was physically ugly. Yeah, he wasn't someone that you would have been attracted to. Y'all looking at me like, y'all go home, y'all think that's Jesus on y'all wall, don't you? That ain't you. No. He was not an attractive person. What is that? Is that Isaiah? I think that's 53. Don't go there. I'm guessing right now. I'm going to my mental concordance. I think it's 53. I'm thinking it is. But if it's not, it talks about his comeliness. Somebody can find that for me later, but it talks about his comeliness, that Jesus was not an attractive person. He wouldn't have been someone you would have run up to and wanted to have a relationship with. And you know, we're visual people, aren't we? Yeah. The first thing we do, when you look at a house, you say, oh, I like that house. I ain't even been in it. Don't you? Isn't that right? You see, oh, I like that car. Hadn't even driven it. Right? You see a person, oh, I like that person. Don't even know them. Right? Isn't that how we look? Because we're so visual. All right? And because of that, what the Bible wants us to know is don't get caught up in the visual. Let me go ahead and give you a life advice. And this is you've heard this. You should not judge a gift by its what? By its cover, but by its content. Right? It's what's on the inside. But even when someone gives you a box that's wrapped, now, oh, that's so pretty. Oh, that, and you spend all that time wrapping it and just making it, but that guy's a bow all of, you don't even know what's in the box. Isn't that right? Isn't that how you do? You go out and get real nice wrapping paper and you want to make it all nice. I don't care as long as they get that tape on and the corners come all like that. I don't care. I just want to know what's in the box. But some of you how many of you get worked up if those corners aren't creased right? Don't raise your hand, because I won't ever give you a present, because you may get it in coloring paper and masking tape. You can see where, or some duct tape. Baby, you got some duct tape? Just tape it in. You know, she wants to get all this tissue paper and this pretty little bag to put it all in. You too, don't you? Yeah, look at it. She got to have it, you know. And some of you, I mean, But Jesus didn't come that way. See, God was concerned about his content more than his cover. Look what he says. He says, the Spirit of the Lord will rest on him. And look what he says he's going to give him. He says the spirit of wisdom. This means to be able to act right, act wisely, to know the right thing to do. How many of you want some of that? That only comes from God. He's saying that he's not going to have a little bit of it. He's going to have all of the wisdom from God. And watch this now. And he's going to have understanding. Now, check this out. You can't have wisdom without understanding. This is why he's coupled these things together if it's going to work well. Because it's one thing to know the right thing to do. It's another thing to do it. Have you ever talked to somebody and said, well, I know what's right, but they're not doing it? Doesn't that just blow your mind that they know the right thing? But if you know the right thing, what's the problem with doing the right thing? Do you struggle with that? I mean, it's not like you don't know, right? It's very little, very seldom is someone telling you, giving you advice of what you don't already know is right. So what he's saying is not that Jesus not only going to know what's right, but he's also going to do what's right. And here's the beautiful thing about it. He's just not going to do what's right when it's convenient. Do we ever just do what's right when it's convenient? But when it gets hard, it's like, I know what I'm supposed to do, but that's hard. Isn't that right? Yeah. I teach my son, and I taught him, I said, look, right is always right, but it's not always easy. You see, it's always right to do the right thing, but it's not always easy. And that's where you say, well, I don't want to hurt their feelings. Well, you're really doing them more harm if you don't tell them what's right. Now, it's a way to do it. You know, it's a way to do it, the right thing. You know, like a lot of these crazy reality shows. I was listening in earshot. And I can't remember. I think she says it was right because she believed it was right. Did you hear what I just said? It was right because she believed it was right. It's not necessarily right, but for her, she could do it because she believed it was right. See, we can't operate on what we believe is right. We gotta know, and that takes wisdom and understanding. Are you seeing this? But he didn't just leave him with just wisdom and understanding. Then he says he gives him counsel and might. Now, that word counsel there means regardless of the situation he finds himself in, God's going to give him what he needs so he can do the right thing at the right time. When you read the book of the New Testament, especially the Gospels, you watch all the times that they try to trap Jesus. You know, they would come up to him with questions like, well, should we pay taxes? You know, like they're going to try to catch him if he's a tax dodger. And what did he say? Render unto Caesar what is the Caesar and unto God what is God. That's wisdom that he showed him, see, that we got to know what God says, right? And we got to know what God says, all right? I mean, we know what the government says and you know what God says. And anytime there's a variance between the two, because we have dual citizenship, I'm going to ask how many of you got dual citizenship? Few more hands, just a few more of you this week. Okay, yes, some of you still like, I don't know. Well, see, they must not have been here, right? Help them out, yes, indeed. Yeah, so if you got dual citizenship, you got a king that you need to follow. And only when the laws of this country go against the laws of the country we're going to, that we have to obey the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Are y'all listening to me here? And sometimes we get trapped, and that's why we need to have wisdom and understanding, and we got to have counsel. But that's not enough. Look what it says, counsel and might. And that word might there means power. Means he's got some Holy Ghost power. He's got the power to do everything that he needs to do. See, you can't do things in your own strength. When the difficult situations come, you need to have something on the inside that you can call on and say, Lord, just give me strength, you know, so that you can have the strength to be able to do what God has called you to do. It's not easy, but if God has empowered you and he developed you and his spirit permeates you, then guess what? Even in your weakness, you can be strong. That's the good news. You see, and so here God, now he's wrapping up this gift. He says, now he's packaging this gift, and he's given, he's promised this gift. But now let's look at the person influencing this gift. Look what it says here now. He says, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord. Now, if you go back to the second verse, you see at the very end of that, he says that the spirit of the knowledge and the fear of the Lord would also rest upon him. Now, this word, the spirit of the of knowledge, doesn't mean some head knowledge. It means that he's going to have the knowledge of God. Oh, you didn't catch that. He's going to know just what God knows. You didn't catch that either. If he knows everything that God knows, then who must he be? He's got to be God. And see, God can't give all of himself to nobody but himself. And so when he gave Jesus all of his knowledge, he's only given his knowledge to himself in the flesh. So here he is now, Jesus in the flesh. He's going to have all the knowledge of God, but he's also now going to have the fear of the Lord. This word fear means reverence and awe. And it says here now in that third verse, with all of this knowledge and with all of this wisdom and with all of this understanding, he's not going to think he's above God, but he's going to reverence God, that he even knows that in his human flesh, he must subject himself to God. And so because of this, now watch how he gets there. He says he delights. Are there some things you delight in? Well, let me use a more contemporary term. Are there things you enjoy doing, going, saying, drinking, smoking, spending? There's some things you enjoy. Right? Come on, let's be real, right? There's some things you enjoy because they make you feel a certain way. All right. Some of us, what is he saying here? Some of us serve the Lord not because we delight in it, but we feel we are obligated to, or we feel it's necessary, or we just do it because it's required of us. But Jesus says he delights in the reverence of the Lord. And this word reverence, again, means to worship and serve. Remember, the word worship is the same word for serving. So when you're worshiping God, you're serving God. And when you're serving God, you're worshiping God. So whether you were worshiping him here or serving him somewhere else, it's all about worship. So that's why the Bible tells us everything we do, do to the glory of God. You can't get out of church because God is everywhere. And everything we do should be done to his glory. And so he's saying here that even when things were difficult for Jesus, Jesus still wanted to please God. That's why when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane and he knew that he was going to go to the cross, when he knew that he had to die for you and for me, he went to the cross, he said, and he went to the garden and said, Father, not my will. In other words, he said, if I had it my way, I wouldn't die for none of y'all. That's what Jesus was saying. In my flesh, if there's another way to do this, if there's another way, Lord, let's figure it out right now. But how many times can you be right there when you find out there's no other way but to do it the way that God has told you to do it? He said, but not my will. Oh, there it is right there. That's his delight. He's saying, Lord, even if it goes against how I feel about it, even if it's not what I want to do personally, even if it's not in my own strength and power, Lord, if this is what you want me to do, not my will, but thy will be done. That's a delight. He said, Father, I'll go to the cross. I'll let them beat me all night. I'll let them pierce me in my side. I'll let them bury me in a borrowed tomb. But when you roll back, he said he had power. Oh, and because he had a power to get up. Why? Because he was worshiping God. Don't you know that nothing, no weapon formed against you can harm you? Huh? If you've got the power that resides within you. So as we wait on this gift,
I want to encourage you during this season not to get all caught up in this commercialism, but to focus on the gift that God was given, that God has given to each of us. Because listen to this now. When you delight in the Lord, you have a source. This is your life advice. You have a source for moral direction from a divine perspective. Did you hear what I just said? When you delight in the Lord, when you spend time with him, this is what Jesus did. He got up early and he spent time with the Lord. He went to the synagogues. He spent time with the Lord. And that allowed him that when he needed to know what to do, when he needed to know the right way to go, he had a moral direction from a divine perspective, meaning that he saw it the way God saw it, so that he could do it the way God wanted it done. That's what God wants from us. So as we're going through this season and get all of this pressure on you to run out to the stores and buy stuff with money you don't have, to impress people you don't like, and buy stuff you don't need, think about the gift that God gave to you. And let that be the gift that you give to someone else. That's your challenge this week. To give the gift to someone else. The gift that God gave to you. But you might say, well, you may not have the gift. Then the first thing you need to do is to receive the gift. Because you can't give what you don't have. Amen. 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 And amen.